Welcome to Buckeyes TomOrrow Morning for Monday, August 26th. I'm your host, Tom Moore. The Akron game in just 5 days. The game against Michigan in 96 days. We are into the first game week of the year for the Ohio State Buckeyes, which means we will start settling into a familiar routine this week. Talking to Brian Day and probably a coordinator or two on Tuesday. Get another chance to talk to Day briefly on Wednesday after practice in the evening, as well as a couple Ohio State players. And then game day on Saturday, 3:30 kickoff for the Buckeyes and Akron Zips on CBS. You'll be there for all of that coverage all through the week, pregame, postgame, the whole deal. College football season finally here. Had a heck of a week zero to start the season. There is a lot to be excited about. Ohio State got a commitment over the weekend from an interior offensive line prospect, Javon McFadden. A bonus episode of that dropped on Sunday in your feed as well. Make sure you check that one out. But before we get into all that, let's talk a little bit about some of the other issues and other questions surrounding this year's Ohio State program as they count down the days to that kickoff on Saturday. Going to be doing that with Ryan Day. Two things we got a chance to talk to Ryan Day about last week that we really have not gotten a chance to do a deep dive into. They're going to let you hear directly from Ryan Day on a few of the sort of lingering questions around this year's Ohio State team. Let's start with the offensive line. The offensive line was the big story of the Buckeyes last game back in the Cotton Bowl. Not in a good way, but they were the big story nonetheless. So what is the message from Ryan Day to the offensive linemen heading into this season?
Yeah, whether it's whatever happened last year is last year, but I know that the message to our offensive line is we want to be the hardest playing offensive line in the country. Now, we got to play with technique. But at the end of the play, like, knock the line of scrimmage back and play with your hair on fire as hard as you possibly can. There's a lot that goes with the playing in the offensive line. There's a lot of communication. There's a lot of things that have to get into place. I think Seth has done a nice job of communicating. He understands the offense better now. He takes control up front and brings everybody together, which is great. But to me, like, that's it. Now, we could list a bunch of other things, but to me, you know, we got to move the line of scrimmage. We got to be just playing with our hair on fire and knocking people back and playing physical. And that's to start the game, and that's to end the game.
As of the last time we talked to Ryan Day, he was not yet ready to announce the starter at right guard. Could be Tager Shibola, could be Carson Hinsman. That decision probably getting made right around now. And then we'll find out a little bit more about that a little later on this week. The other position where there hadn't really been an official announcement about a leader in the clubhouse, a starter, projected starter for that position, was at the will linebacker spot. Sonny Styles, CJ Hicks battling for that starting role. What is the situation right now at the will linebacker spot?
So Sonny has really stepped up and played well. He's made this transition from safety to linebacker very well. I think he did a nice job in the spring, but you could definitely see as he went into the summer, just, you know, bigger, stronger, being more comfortable closer to the line of scrimmage. It's different when you're closer to the line of scrimmage. He's doing a better job getting his, you know, hands on offensive linemen and getting off of blocks. You know, doing a better job with his hands. I think he understands the communication. You know, the linebackers always have to be involved with the front, and they got to be involved and fit into the back end. He's doing that. I think he's looking forward to playing in a game and, you know, getting an idea of what it all looks like. But I can tell you in practice, he's playing fast, he's playing violent, and I think he does a nice job of taking the meeting to the field, being very intentional about his work, but playing really hard.
A position where the Buckeyes had a little bit of an issue towards the end of last season, especially in that Cotton Bowl, was at center. Carson Hinsman wasn't there. Matt Jones filled in. It did not go great. So then when they added Seth McLaughlin in the portal from Alabama in early January, it felt like, well, you know, this is not a bad option. It's at least another solid choice there. We'll see how it goes. And it seems like, from all accounts, it has gone great for Seth McLaughlin at Ohio State. He has won that starting center job, be the starting center this week against Akron. And when guys have talked about Seth McLaughlin, they've talked about the fact you can just kind of tell he's been there before. This is not new to him. He's a starter at Alabama for a number of years. Now, it's new at Ohio State, but it's not new to him, really. So when you say that Seth McLaughlin acts like he's been there before, how does that actually show up?
A bunch of ways. It's just poise. It's not getting rattled when, you know, coach barks at you. It's, you know, okay, I got this. Let me get it under control. It's seeing something in practice and being able to adjust on the move. It's being prepared when you walk on the field. It's recognizing how hard you have to play at the position. It's kind of all of those things into one. But he's got great communication up front. He talks to the guys. He's moving quickly in there. And when you have experience like he has, you know, the game seems to slow down at times. Yet, he seems to be playing at a fast level.
Ohio State had a pair of five-star wide receivers in its class of 2024. You have heard all about Jeremiah Smith. Basically, since the day he stepped on campus, he has been one of, if not the single biggest story around this year's Ohio State team. But there is another five-star wide receiver in that class. You haven't heard quite as much about Mylon Graham, and a lot of that has to do with the fact that he did not enroll early. He showed up in June, so did not take part in spring practice. Been a little lower on the depth chart than Jeremiah Smith and then some other guys as well, but he did lose his black stripe earlier this summer. That was pretty quick for a true freshman. So is he someone who's maybe going to force his way into that wide receiver rotation this season?
Yeah, there was a point where he got a black stripe off, and I feel like he took a step in the right direction. When you come in the summer, it is very difficult to get on the field, especially early in the season. Whether he does or not, we'll see. But if he continues to practice the way that he's been practicing, then he'll give himself a chance to be in the rotation midway through the season or later in the season, which is similar to some of the wide receivers we've had before. You know, you've seen some of those guys get some reps early in the season, but then make an impact later in the season. I think that's probably more his path right now. Now, you know, he shows up and starts doing great, then, you know, we'll give him the reps he deserves. Where like Jeremiah is in a different situation because, you know, he came in here in January and he was a little bit ahead. Anybody who comes in January, to me, I don't look at them as a freshman anymore. They've been here, they're in the program, and we expect them to contribute.
Here's one of these stories that was just an ever-present part of the 2023 Ohio State season. Ryan Day calling plays. Is he going to hand over control to Brian Hartline? When is he going to make the decision? He's got an offensive coordinator. Is Ryan Day just going to keep calling plays? How does it impact you? That story got beat to death a year ago. It's funny that since Chip Kelly showed up in Columbus, it has just sort of gone away. There's been no questions, no drama around it, no uncertainty. It's Chip Kelly's going to be calling plays, and Ryan Day's going to be doing all the other stuff because Ryan Day knows he needs to be able to focus on all the other stuff. So, with Ryan Day not calling plays this season, what has he been doing during the scrimmages, the mock game that they had over the weekend? What is Ryan Day doing with all his free time on the sideline now that he's not actively calling every play?
I'm still in there, right there, talking and communicating. But in the scrimmages we've had, it's been offense versus defense. So I've mostly been on the offensive side, still kind of going through all those types of things. And there's a lot to work through this year just with, you know, the play clock. And then what I mean by that is, you know, the coast to player communication inside of 15 goes off. Just there's a lot of things that go on there. And we don't really get notification on that. So I'm trying to, you know, just help Chip with that and some communication that way, personnel. But I'm going to be very much involved with special teams. I think with the 2-minute warning, there's some strategic things that are going to go on at the end of half, end of game that, you know, I got to really be involved with. But to your point, just overall, just looking guys in the eye, making sure that, you know, they got the right look in their eye, that they understand, you know, with the situation, what's going on in the game. You know, I think that happens sometimes with young players. You know, they're just like playing the next play. You know, and that's not how it works. We've got to win the situations, and so, you know, all those things will come into play and making in-game adjustments. You know, being involved with on all three phases. You know, watching, you know, the game on a tablet to try to identify what happened in the last series. I think all those things will be happening.
And finally, if the offensive line position, if Jeremiah Smith, if the linebacker position battle have not been the biggest stories of the year, well, then it definitely would be the battle for the starting quarterback position. Kyle McCord started all 12 regular season games last year for the Buckeyes, then hit the transfer portal, ended up at Syracuse. Devin Brown started the Cotton Bowl against Missouri, got hurt pretty much immediately. Lincoln Keenholz filled in for him. But then after the Cotton Bowl, Will Howard committed to Ohio State in the transfer portal, showed up in the spring, had a solid spring, not solid if unspectacular spring, let's say. But then this fall really seemed like he took over that quarterback position. It seemed like he won that quarterback battle. Pretty clearly, there wasn't a ton of drama around that one this fall. So it feels like the Buckeye coaching staff is feeling pretty good about Will Howard. Feels like he certainly raises the floor of what this Ohio State team is going to be. But what's the ceiling there? And What kind of traits does Ryan Day see out of Will Howard that he likes that made him win that starting quarterback job?
I see a bunch of traits there. I think the first trait is size. He's big. He can stand in the pocket, and he's strong. That's the first thing you notice about him. Again, whether it's standing in the pocket with poise, I think that's another trait that he has that's excellent. He feels the rush, but he stands right in there. I think the next trait is just, you know, his top-end speed. I mean, he can run 22 miles an hour at that size, which there's not a lot of guys who can do that. So I think that's an extraordinary trait. And I would say his overall leadership, command in the huddle is another, you know, something that he's really, you know, grown into in the last few months when he's been here. And then his accuracy. You know, he's been very accurate since he's been here. And when he knows what's going on and he can anticipate what's happening, I mean, it looks right. You just feel it. And he can hurt you, you know, a bunch of different ways. So, his ceiling, you know, that's going to be kind of, you know, up to how he plays this season. But, I see a player who has a lot of great skills that, you know, translates well to the next level. So, you know, we'll see. But I know his first focus is on winning games around here.
We are going to be heading into our game week routine now. Finally, after the longest offseason in major North American sports, we are finally here. College football season, cannot wait. There's going to be a ton of content coming for you this week at BuckeyeHuddle.com and, of course, at YouTube.com/BuckeyeHuddle. If you're on YouTube, make sure you are subscribed. We tell you that all the time. Make sure you hit that bell. We'll tell you that, too. Really important. There's going to be a lot of stuff coming out this week. If you don't want to miss it, all you got to do is hit a button. It's really not that hard. Hit that bell as well. Then you get notified when we do live shows. We'll have live interviews this week. We'll have live shows. We'll have pregame. We'll have live postgame show. Tons of content coming for you this week, all at YouTube.com/BuckeyeHuddle. And, of course, at BuckeyeHuddle.com as well. That's where Kevin, Tony, and I cover the team. Mark covers recruiting. Got our whole team of X's and O's gurus are going to be very busy this week, breaking down the Ohio State offense, breaking down the Ohio State defense, what they're learning, what they're seeing, what you need to know. That's all at BuckeyeHuddle.com. Sign up there, become a member. Great way to support our work. Also, a great way to stay in touch with all the latest around the Ohio State football team. Everything you need to know, all in one place, all at BuckeyeHuddle.com. That'll do it for today. Thank you guys all for joining us. Have a great day. We'll talk to you tomorrow.